The best choice here is the acute disseminated encephalomyelitis or ADEM. So some of the key features include on flare, you see there are multiple bilateral lesions but asymmetric in distribution involving the juxtacortical and subcortical white matter. You also see very little involvement of the corpus callosum. So if you're thinking about the myelating process, that would be atypical for MS. Also, in this particular case, you see very little involvement of the periventricular white matter. Again, that's not common for MS. On the other hand, you do see the involvement of deep gray, involvement of thalamus, involvement of the putamen. That is fairly common for ADEM, but not very common for MS. For the spinal cord lesion, you can see there's a transverse myelitis that expands greater than 3 vertebral body segments, so that's longitudinally extensive transverse myelitis. Compare that to MS, MS tend to be short, less than 2 vertebral body segments, and they tend to be peripheral in location. So for ADEM, it's a post-viral autoimmune demyelinating condition, and typically occur in kids over adults. So a classic scenario would be a child presented with acute demyelination. He or she has a recent history of viral illness. Another thing that we discover is that up to 1/3 or even half of the patient with ADEM would test positive for MOG antibody or myelin oligodendrocyte glycoprotein antibody. And this is going to be important, and more you're going to hear about MOG AD or MOG antibody associated disorders. So it's something that is good for you to become familiar with. There are some key differences between the chief differential diagnosis for ADEM, which is MS. For example, MS can occur in young adults as opposed to kids. And for classic MS, MS should not test positive for MOG. On imaging, there are some features that will lead me toward MS over ADEM. For example, if I see multiple lesions involving the corpus callosum, especially under surface of the corpus callosum, the callosal subtle interface, I would go with MS. If I see a lot of deep gray involvement, I would go with ADEM. If I see a longitudinally extensive transverse myelitis, I would go with ADEM. MS lesions tend to be short and peripheral. So this will be a classic example of MS. You can see multiple periventricular lesion that is perpendicular to the axis of the lateral ventricle, the so-called Dawson's finger lesion. And there are lesions involving the corpus callosum, especially the undersurface of corpus callosum, so the callosal subtle interface. The MS core lesion, they tend to be short segment, less than 2 vertebral body segment. Compare that to ADEM, they tend to be longitudinally extensive, greater than 3 vertebral body segment. What about other choices that do not work as well in this case? For example, choice A, neuromyelitis optica. For NMO, we typically think of them as a disease that involving the transverse myelitis, usually also longitudinally extensive transverse myelitis with optic neuritis. It was thought that the brain should be normal, or at least near normal, but that's not entirely true. What you're looking for is an area that's rich with aquaporin 4 water channels. So aquaporin 4 water channels are embedded within the astrocyte foot process. Like in this diagram, you can see multiple channels that's embedded within the astrocyte and foot. They are responsible for water homeostasis. So they tend to cluster around the ventricle, around the CSF, and around the periependymal region. So you can test for aquaporin 4 antibody. If you have NMO antibody positivity, then you have NMO. On the other hand, the patient may present with a classic symptom of NMO, but test negative for this antibody. And with that, you can still, if patient has a two core clinical characteristic, by current definition, you can still diagnose that with NMOSD. That accounts for about 30% of the patient. So what are the area that's aquaporin 4 rich? And as I mentioned earlier, they tend to cluster around the ventricle where the CSF is. So that means that they tend to be around the outer ventricle, around the third ventricle, hypothalamus, around the fourth ventricle, and along the central canal, presented with a longitudinally extended transverse myelitis. One location I want you to focus on, though, is area postrema at the level obex, or the inferior aspect of the floor of the fourth ventricle. So if you have a lesion involved in this area, the patient will typically present with area postrema syndrome, present with refractory hiccup or refractory vomiting. This is one of the defining core clinical characteristics for NMOSD. For choice B mesotrexic toxicity, the classic picture is that you have a confluent area abnormal flare and diffusion restriction involving the centrinsome valley and coronal radiata. Sometimes the diffusion abnormality will occur before you see the flare signal abnormality. So this is a classic picture, and if patients receiving treatment for mesotrexate, particularly intrathecal mesotrexate, then you have a diagnosis. The core involvement for mesotrexic toxicity essentially look identical to subacute combined degeneration due to vitamin B12 deficiency. So next time if you see a dorsal column involvement, my chief differential diagnosis is vitamin B12 deficiency. Differential diagnosis may also include mesotrexic toxicity, so check to see if the patient is under treatment for intrathecal mesotrexate. For HERB encephalitis, the classic picture of HERB encephalitis is involvement of the temporal lobe, particularly the mesotemporal lobe. They are typically bilateral, but they are often asymmetric, just like in this case. Often there's a varied degree of enhancement as well as restricted diffusion. Sometimes you can see microhemorrhage. Obviously, it's very important to think about the differential diagnosis. You want to treat the patient empirically before the result comes back. And we already talked about multiple sclerosis, why that's not good for this particular case. That's all for this pediatric neuro case number 10. Good luck on your board exam. Thank you.